Coleman looked down from the first floor window of the bookshop and saw his dead wife standing on the pavement below. He had been amongst the shelves all afternoon, thumbing through the second-hand books from front to back, pausing at folded over corners or where the text had been underlined, flicking through the pages to persuade them to offer up what might be hiding between the leaves. The cup of tea that Viv had brought for him had cooled, forgotten on the window seat. At about 3 o'clock, he had picked up Who Was Changed and Who Was Dead, a book he recognised and thought he might already own. It had fallen open, and there, tucked between the pages, he had been surprised to see a folded sheet of thin yellow paper with faint blue lines. Trembling, Gil had sat down beside the cup and turned the book sideways so he could open the note without removing it. One of his rules was that the things he found must never be taken out from their original location. He lifted both the book and the piece of paper up to the rain-streaked window. It was another letter, handwritten in black ink, and when he squinted, he could read the date, the 2nd of July, 1992, 2:17 p.m., and under that, his own name. The text below was smaller, and the writer had paid no attention to the lines provided, but had allowed their words to slope downhill as if they had written them at speed. He patted the breast of his jacket, swapped the book to his other hand, and dipped into the inside pockets, then tapped the sides of his trousers. No reading glasses. He moved the letter nearer and further away from his face to bring the writing into focus, and leaned closer to the window. The light was poor. The storm, which had been forecast for Saturday, had arrived a day early. When Gil had locked his car in the car park beside the Jurassic Crazy Golf playground, he saw that the wind had wrapped a plastic bag around one of the front claws of the Tyrannosaurus Rex, so that the creature appeared to be about to step over the wire fence on its way to do some shopping. And as Gil had walked along the promenade to the bookshop, the wind had gouged troughs in the grey sea and flung the top edges of the waves towards the land, so that now, standing amongst the old books, he could taste salt on his lips. A blast of rain rapped on the window, and that was when he turned to look out and down to the narrow street below. On the pavement opposite, a woman in an oversized greatcoat stood gazing along the road. Only the tips of her fingers showed from the ends of the sleeves, while the bottom hem came almost to her ankles. The coat was a dirty olive colour from the rain, the cast of the sea after a shower, and it occurred to Gil that his daughter Flora would know the colour's proper name. The woman pushed a strand of wet hair off her face with the back of her wrist and turned towards the bookshop. The gesture was so shockingly familiar that Gil stood up and was unaware of knocking over his cup of tea. The woman tilted her heart-shaped face to look up, as if she knew Gil was watching, and in that moment he understood the woman was his wife, older but without doubt, he thought, her. The rain had flattened and darkened her hair, and the water dripped off her chin, but she stared at him in the same defiant way she had when he had first met her. He would have known that expression and that woman anywhere. Ingrid.